Argentina had arrived in Switzerland at last and was standing in an airport in a small crowd, waiting for her luggage. She had come back to visit her musical mentor, Master Chen, a Tai Chi master, whose sage guidance had opened the door to her artistry and her career. 10 years had passed so quickly, a life of airports, concert halls, hotels, and performances. These were her bread and butter. While she was an acclaimed bass virtuoso on stage, her private life was a song of hello, goodbye, we should get together. She yearned to see Master Chen, for career was not enough. She ached simply to be happy. Checking into the hotel, there would be time for a nap before the cab came to take her to the master's mountain home. She drew the curtains, leaned back in bed, closed her eyes. Soon the phone rang loudly. Anna sat up. The front desk was calling. Where was she? Had she missed a rehearsal? They called to say that an older gentleman was waiting in the lobby. He had not left his name. It was Master Chen. He had come to town to see her. What to do? She took a moment to freshen up and then rushed down to the lobby. Master Chen was delighted to see her, a childlike smile crinkling his ancient eyes. He beamed, "Oh, Anna, such a pleasure. You are lovely as ever." Anna laughed, "You're too kind. How are you? It's so good to see you again." Master Chen lifted up a gold-tipped cane. "Well, I use this now. I turned my ankle near the mountain stream we visited. Do you remember?" "Of course I remember. I remember everything we did, everything you said." She hugged him softly. "You are the one who brought my music to life." Mr. Chen shrugged and tilted his head. "I was only a guide. Now, let me ask a question. Do you have time to explore today, Anna? A little time with an old friend? Today I'm yours, but when do we work on our music?" Master Chen waved his hand. "No playing today, just looking around. Come, let's walk." "Where are we going?" A little surprise. And they both walked a few blocks away into the National Fine Arts Museum, a favorite of Master Chen's. Drifted off to the Impressionist, sat down before Monet's painting, Dance Above It All. She savored the muted but ardent passion of the man dancing with the woman. Time softened and she reflected on her solo life, wondering when she might meet someone. And then she came up from her reflection, looked around, said to herself, "Now where is Master Chen?" She found him having tea in the museum cafe, and she joined him and said, "Master Chen, besides missing you, I did come from another reason." Master Chen smiled, "Yes, Anna?" "Well, it's wonderful when I play music. The audience is there listening, but later..." "Yes," he encouraged. "What is it like later?" "Well, in the hotel room, I sit down on the bed and look out of the window at the bright lights, and I wonder what my grandfather Carl what he felt on his musical tours when he was away from my grandma Sophie. He loved her very much, you must know. Well, I do know, said Anna, but that's the thing. When there is someone who waits for your call, who wants to hear the sound of your voice, everything changes. Master Chen stirred his tea and nodded, yes, I see. Anna lowered her eyes, folded her napkin slowly, and said softly, Master Chen, my cell phone, I have a million telephone numbers, all good friends, but not one to call my own. Master Chen nodded, yes, full suitcase, but empty heart. Anna turned quickly. Now, don't get me wrong. I love my playing, my concerts. Master Chen nodded. Yes, I know, Anna. Now, play a little game with me. And Master Chen reached out both of his closed hands to hers and insisted, pick one, Anna. For in one of my hands is everything that will make you happy. Quick, which one do you choose? Oh, wait a minute, I don't get it. Oh, Anna, he urged, stop thinking. It is not to be so logical. Life holds out its hands and it says, choose, pick a path, a person, a chance, or love, and your life changes. Go out into the world with that spirit and life will sparkle with possibilities. Anna asked, but what if you don't have time for love? Master Chen winked, oh my child, the night is young and the moon is full. Come with me. He led her to a special exhibit featuring Pablo Casals, a video playing on one wall. In it, Casals passionately playing Bach Prelude in G, while on the other wall, Casals sitting in a sunny garden, teaching cello to a student, yet talking about love. He's teaching the young girl that music itself can only go so far. Saying that the soul needs three gifts from love. Love of people, love of beauty and nature, love of artistic masterpiece. These would inspire your artistry, said Casals. Before they left the museum, Master Chen paused, drew Anna down the steps to the balcony overlook of the museum's entrance. The spectacle of trees, skyline, sidewalk traffic was splendid. He asked Anna to close her eyes and then he whispered, Anna, listen to my voice. Relax, let everything else go and think only about love. Ask life to grant your eyes and ears passion in all things music. Hear love's voice. In a song, a lover's laugh, bells that ring. Let love's light seem in people's faces. Branches in a tree, sparkle of a running brook. Wherever you are, let love reveal the secrets of your heart. Anna opened her eyes and said, I will be open. Thank you. Walking out of the museum, Master Chen and Anna strolled silently on the sidewalk back to the hotel. In front of a park entrance, they saw two musicians, a boy and a girl, playing for a crowd. It became obvious that they were in love. Their smiles, their eyes did not wander. They were fixed on each other. Their little duets seemed to swing in a playful, jazzy way, seasoned by whimsy and affection. The two musicians finally moved closer, and at the end of the piece, merging their melodies as one during a last sustained note, they leaned and kissed one another. The crowd erupted. Music, money dropped in their boxes, and Master Chen nudged Anna. See? It's working already. I know, Anna said, but I want to be in those duets. I want to be who's in that kiss. Where and how will I get that love? Supper in the hotel, Master Chen told Anna the story about her grandparents, Carl and Sophie, their first meeting. It seems that Anna's grandfather, Carl, had ordered roses in a flower shop to go to his mother for Mother's Day. The shop girl misplaced the address and called grandfather Carl to ask where that address was. Sophie, that was your grandmother, Anna. Carl liked the sound of her voice right away, and he said he would like to come down to the shop, and that he would deliver the flowers himself, no problem. Of course, he really wanted to meet that nice young voice over the end of the phone. So Grandfather Carl came down to the shop, enjoyed chatting with her. As he left the shop, he turned around and came back, pulled one of the roses from the bouquet, smiled, and offered it to her. She said, but you'll be one rose short. Carl shrugged, perhaps, but a girl like you deserves a rose. Please enjoy. Master Chen added a spontaneous impulse. He could have left the flower shop, never looking back, but he didn't. And so he married Sophie, your grandmother. They had children, grandchildren, and here you are, Anna, because of a single rose. Anna smiled. You are forever the romantic, Master Chen, and I love you for it. Thank you for your kindness, your attention, understanding. Always, my dear, you. said with a twinkle in his eye. Leaving Switzerland the next day, Anna resumed her concert tour to Latin America. She would visit the Caribbean, Brazil, Argentina. But on this exotic tour, she had a new agenda to find the passion inspired by that Casals exhibit. She wanted to spend time experiencing the wonders of nature, rainforest, exotic birds of South America. She was excited to experience ethnic rhythms, harmonic sambas from Argentina.
Thank you.
Piazzolla, who wrote the libertango that Anna played so well, and now she could test out her famous sultry interpretation in its native environment. Though mid-size, were full, and after a performance, Anna went with a girlfriend to a little club in a part of the city they called San Telmo, where local tango dancers danced and the young gathered. El Fuego Azul was a simple, rustic, but fashionable spot, densely packed, a smoky destination in an old back street reminiscent of Paris. The tango dancers crowded on a floor. Anna wondered what it would feel like to be held that close. Their drinks came, the music was intoxicating. There was something in the tango she wanted to touch or that touched her that night. It was as if life took new colors of sound out of a box and sent them to her ears. Then after receiving a call, her friend rushed out of the club, leaving Anna. Anna sitting there listening to the tango. When out of the club shadow, a young man quietly approached. He was tall and dark, and in a closer light, she thought of him as handsome. Uh-oh, here it comes. She thought, he's gonna flirt with me. But he smiled and walked right past her. She thought. Then a moment later, a waiter appeared with a red rose and placed it in the empty glass on her table. What's this, said Anna. The waiter turned. It's from the gentleman near the piano. He noticed that your vase was empty, and actually we ran out, and so he sent his own. There it was, tall, dark, handsome. He was letting a flower do his work, and so she got up and she walked over to the piano to see who he was, or thank him, or ask him why. She lost track of time. Perhaps it was the Argentine Malbec, making everything seem delightful and funny. Then there he was, smiling, shrugging his shoulders, saying, I just thought a pretty young woman like you should not be without a rose. You know, that's such a line, she mused. In his arms like cream into coffee. She was dizzy, and so to balance, she focused on a cute little scar he had above his eye and asked him how he got it. He said that was a long story, and she heard herself reply, that's okay. We have all night. It was not like her to make a pass. Oh, well, she thought, I'm in Argentina. Life is asking me to pick a hand. His name was Rodrigo Mateo, and he said he knew who she was from newspapers and told her that he was a music producer, mostly with up-and-coming solo artists. And so she took a chance and told him about Carl and Sophie and the Rose story. He said his parents' story paled by comparison. His parents met on a stalled commuter train, and they shared a banana. Anna and Rodrigo talked and laughed until late and closed the doors of the club, and finally she asked about that little scar. Oh, that? One day my sister chased me through the house and I hit myself on our grand piano. Poor thing, she cooed and touched his forehead, and they walked out of the club and looked at the stars. The night was beautiful, and they realized that they were together, side by side, strolling down the streets. And Anna with the table rose in her hand. Anna went away on tour again, but in 3 weeks there was a break and she came back to Buenos Aires. Rodrigo showed her the natural wonders beyond the city, the rainforest, the beautiful Iguazu Falls. Her eyes looked around in awe, entering sacred realms of beauty and silence. The harmony between the two of them grew into a major chord. She had an impulse to play her bass under the canopies of the rainforest with the sun kissing her hands. It was marvelous. Thank you. 10 days later, Anna was invited to play on an important network television program honoring the roots of Argentine music. Her name had been suggested, and she was thrilled. They asked if she would play the Libertango piece. And then unexpectedly, the producer apologized, withdrew the offer to have her play, citing that the prestigious Argentine band they originally wanted, Años Dorados, was now available for the broadcast. Anna was very disappointed. Rodrigo was even more upset. He finally confessed that Años Dorados was in fact a very popular band, led by his own father, Alejandro Mateo. Anna asked Rodrigo why he had kept this a secret. And so Rodrigo said it was a challenge growing up in his father's shadow, always wanting to carve out a space of his own. Well, she understood, but she was still hurt. Alejandro Mateo learned of the situation by talking to his son. He felt awkward about the position that he had placed people in. So he invited Anna to play for him, to see if there were some special way to include her. He would hear her sound and know, for his own listening went deep. So one afternoon, Anna accepted Alejandro's offer, came to a studio to meet over coffee. After talking, he asked her to play, and with great concentration and sincerity, she took up her instrument, lit into the Libertango, and then in the middle of playing, stopped suddenly. She knew she was forcing the feelings and said to him, "Let me begin again." And he nodded, of course, but she never played, tears welling up. She confessed, "I feel I just don't have it." Alejandro smiled, rose, walked over, came to comfort her, putting his hand on her shoulder. "Dear me, you are trying so hard. You don't need to, you know." With that, he sat down at the grand piano, continued playing the tune where she left off effortlessly, for this music was an old friend. When he was done, he winked. "Slow down, child, you'll get there. Play from your heart, let it be. Young heart, young music, more years, more history, a different sound. Both are true. Both are true." Thank you. Alejandro offered to coach her and play in a new composition for his band entitled Memorias de mi Papá, a tribute to his own father, also a prominent band leader. He told her how long it took for him to believe that he could measure up to his father's great reputation, how artists in the end can only answer to the gift of their own talent. The love of Rodrigo, the kindness of Alejandro gave Anna wings, and the television concert was a success. Visit Master Chen a year later. She would tell the master about Rodrigo and the education of her heart. And she would give Master Chen a stone that she had plucked from a mountain stream in Argentina in the rainforest, and it would be placed in the white bowl the master had set out to mark her earlier lessons. During that visit, Anna could not help but notice that Master Chen's life force had dimmed slightly, and that in fact he was frail. The March wind blew cold around his home, and it took a fire burning in the hearth to warm his hands. Gazing at him, sitting in that chair, Anna realized that he would one day pass from this world. And at the end of her visit, Anna asked Master Chen what she could possibly do to repay him for all that he had taught her. He paused and smiled, considering her question, his cat leaping up on his lap, curling into a question mark. He stroked his cat and he offered, "Anna, your gift to me will be to go into the world and teach others, help them find their gift as you have found yours. Do this with all of the love that you have in your heart." Her eyes welled with tears. She took his hand. "Mr. Chen, I promise to pass my gift to others and teach them what you have taught me." "Good, Anna," he said, "then the music will never end. The love